Good evening and welcome to the Rial Community Committee for April the 8th, 2019. I just want to acknowledge that Winnipeg is located within Treaty 1 territory, traditional lands of the Anishinaabe, Ojibwe, Inuwe Cree, Ojibwe, Dene, and Dakota people, and is the birthplace of the Métis Nation and the heart of the Métis Nation homeland. Tonight, we have our chairperson, myself, Marcus Chambers. I am with the St. Norbert, St. River Ward. I'm joined today by my esteemed colleagues. To my left, Councillor Allard of the St. Boniface Ward and Councillor Mays of the St. Vital Ward. Also with us today is Rochelle Verret with the City Clerk's Department, as well as Elise Finnegan with our Property Planning and Development, as well as Jonathan Hildebrand, who's also with Property Planning and Development. So welcome here tonight. First, we have to move the minutes from our last meeting. Have you had a chance to review?
I'll move the minutes.
Okay, so Councillor Allard has moved adoption of the minutes. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Okay, we have, we're starting with delegations? Okay, we have delegations. First, we have Julie Turin-Menard, who will be heard in support of the Community Incentive Grant for the Catholic Health Corporation of Manitoba.
Good afternoon, bon après-midi. I'd also like to introduce to you Danielle Lucier, who's just sitting beside me, who's the CEO of the Catholic Health Corporation of Manitoba and the applicant, that we've applied for to redevelop a section of the Taché Promenade Riverwalk.
Yes, I just want to let you know that we do have interpretation services, so you may speak to the committee in French or English.
Okay. Je l'ai écrit en anglais, fait que je vais parler en anglais.
Okay. So you know.
Okay, so this project will not only complete another section of the loop that connects the east and west side of the Red River between St. Boniface and the Forks, but it's also a project that's going to pay tribute to the Grey Nuns who arrived on the banks of the Red River 175 years ago. So we're aiming to enhance a generation-old hardscape project along the riverbank by the St. Boniface General Hospital with new landscaping, in addition to a monument and an art piece designed by the artist Madeleine Vrignon that will render homage to the Grey Nuns. So the Catholic Health Corporation is financing 88% of this project, and we'd be extremely grateful if the Rial Community Committee will move to approve its budget through the CIGP grant in the amount of $20,000. I presume that you have looked at all the information that I sent you in the CIGP grant, and if you have any questions, I'd be pleased to answer them for you.
Thank you, Julie. To my colleagues, I'm aware of this project. I think it's a beautiful addition to some of the work that's been done in the area. Thank you very much for to the corporation for your leadership on this, and hope to be able to secure this grant later this evening with consultation with my colleagues.
Sounds good.
Thank you.
How many years have you been fundraising for this?
Well, the Catholic Health Corporation of Manitoba took over the works of the Grey Nuns, so they have put funds into place to do specific projects, and with the 175th occurring this year, they devoted a specific amount to be able to support the development of this project.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
See
you. Thank you.
You're good?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
So up next we have Jagdev Kelsey to be heard in a support of a non-conforming approach at 632 Grierson Avenue in Fort Richmond.
Hi, good evening, everybody. I got some notes for everybody. If you wish, I can show them. Okay.
You may proceed.
Hi, Ed. Well, we applied for a new design for an older house, which is a infill lot, and property is located 632 Grierson Avenue. And its alignment has been done by property planning department. They had no problem with it. Also, they had design approval. They had no concern. But we recently heard last Thursday from Public Work, they had some concern, which they are saying it will not be approved because of those concerns. One of them was a tree in the way. So they asking for $1,675 for a tree removal or maybe need to replace. I have no problem with it. I can pay the cost. That's fine with me. I think a second question they were saying about the shortage of parking, but I did not see any issue because there is only 1 hour parking and nobody parks there. I took some pictures. If council wants to see it, I have no problem with it.
Sure, if you have pictures to share.
Yeah. Let's see here. I think he's emailed them to me. Just 1 second. I can forward them off to you. Just 1 second. Yeah, he's got some pictures here I can forward. I'll forward the pictures that you sent earlier.
Okay, thanks.
Okay.
Anybody receive them? Get the photos?
Yeah.
Okay. Any questions? No? Okay. You can proceed.
Yeah, property to the west of 632 Grierson, they have a front access. And property to the east side, they have a front garage as well. Property across the road, they have a front drive as well. But I think, I don't know, it's what's the concern about the new design. And if there's any concern, I'm still ready to cooperate. Okay, thanks.
On your side of the street, how many houses have a front approach?
Just beside my house, they have a front approach.
So that doesn't give me totality. How many houses on your side of the street, immediately adjacent, have on Grierson, have front approaches?
As far as I can see, there is 634, the next house, they have front approach. But other than that, they have a rear, I think, garage on the rear back lane.
There's only one house on your side of the street that has the front approach?
Yes.
The rest all have their parking in the back lane?
Yes, sir.
And where is your current parking?
We have no garage, so there is a huge backyard. So in case we need to park, there is a parking, but it's really far away because lot is 150 feet deep. So if I have to build a garage, it will be all the way to the backside. In the winter time, so I have to walk 100 feet to come to my house. So I have to shovel the snow every day.
But you also have a side approach?
Yes, there is. There is side approach, but just in case of extension in the future of my house, if I build a garage on the backside, then I have to move the garage all the way to the back again, so it's not convenient anyways. It will be very expensive. Because it will restriction, like kind of a future extension, just in case.
Any other questions?
No, thank you.
So just reading in the report, there is going to be, this would require removal of a tree?
Yes, sir.
Would you be replacing the tree?
Yeah, I have no problem with it. I can pay the cost, or I can move the tree on different place on my cost.
So the assessed value of the tree is $1,675?
Yes. Yes, sir.
So you'd be prepared to make an equivalent investment?
Yeah, I can do that.
Okay.
Okay. I have no further questions at this point.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Okay. We have the following persons to be heard in support of plan approval at Desi Burnett Boulevard. First, Brian Ward, followed by Trevor Grafton and George Datira. You want to come forward? Hi, go ahead.
Hello, it's Brian Ward of Qualico Communities, 1 Dr. David Friesen Drive. There is another item on the agenda as the part of the public hearing dealing with a variance. So I will be back to speak to any details of the variance, which could also address plan approval and siting, which is what the variances are related to. So we have reviewed the report. We have no issues or concerns with the report on the plan approval from the administration. As always, happy to answer any questions, and we will certainly get into more details with the variance application that are rather pertinent to the plan approval.
And that's on a different property or the same? The
same property, same agenda later this evening as part of the public hearing portion of the meeting. There's a variance, excuse me, that would really deal with the details of the plan approval.
Okay.
Any questions at this point? Wait for the hearing?
Wait, yeah.
Perfect. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. And then the following persons are to be heard in opposition of plan approval at number 9 and number 11 Clonard Avenue. Pam St. Goddard, she'll be followed by Tim Higgins and Irene Dutiam. No worries.
My apologies. We thought we were number 28 or 29 on the agenda, and we didn't know how this worked. I'm going to defer to Tim to speak, please.
Okay.
Thank you, Pam. My name is Tim Higgins. Mr. Chairman, councilors, I'm appearing before you today on behalf of the Glenwood Neighborhood Association. Our position is that the developer has not fulfilled the conditions placed on his proposal and that therefore construction should not proceed at 11 Clonard. My brief concerns the trees on the lot. We see two problems here. First, subsection 247, number 3 of the City of Winnipeg Charter states that a variance shall not have a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining properties and adjacent area. The major tree in consideration here, a lovely, healthy, mature silver maple, appears to be to the east of the lot line marker, that is, on the adjoining lot. Therefore, it's unclear to us how damaging the root system of this tree, as this proposed construction must undoubtedly do, can fail to have a substantial adverse effect on the adjoining property. Second, There is a required arborist, there is the required arborist report. The Planning, Property, and Development Department's website lays out in some detail the requirements for a valid arborist report. These include the tree species, the tree's size, its condition rating, recommendation for tree protection, details for pruning, and a schedule for site inspection and status reporting to the city by qualified arborist throughout the construction period. In the appended arborist report, you'll see the tree species, and that's it. We also note that an acceptable arborist report must be prepared by a qualified arborist. Planning, Property, and Development defines a qualified arborist as either a certified arborist certified by the International Society of Consulting Arborists, a consulting arborist registered with the American Society of Consulting Arborists, or a registered professional forester. In this case, the arborist report is signed by Mr. Mark Oswald, who is identified as the owner of Stump Busters, a company that cuts down trees. Is Mr. Oswald a qualified arborist? On the basis of this document, I have no idea. So our question concerning this arborist report is this: should a document that appears to meet none of the basic requirements be accepted as meeting the conditions set out for approval? We fail to see how it can. Mr. Chairman, councillors, this request for approval is just one more example of the uneven playing field that the residents of Glenwood have faced since this situation began. If the city is unwilling or unable to enforce its own rules, what option do we have but to oppose, while we wait for the guidelines that will make the city's densification plan transparent, fair, and equitable for everyone? On the basis of this approach, it's been said that we, the GNA, are holding the process hostage. Nothing could be further from the truth. The Glenwood Neighborhood Association will continue to take an active, positive role in this process until there is a densification plan in place that meets everyone's needs, the city, the builders, and most importantly, the people who are being asked to live with the results. On that basis, and in consideration of the fact that the developer has failed to meet the conditions set, we urge you to deny the request for approval before you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Councillor Mays has a question.
So the other conditions were about entrance door being constructed at grade level. I understand that's being done. So it's the key thing here is the arborist report.
In our opinion, at this point, yes.
And do we want to get, at this stage then, Mr. Chair, do we want a response from, can the admin speak to whatever was produced in terms of the arborist report?
Yeah.
Is actually here who commissioned the report. So maybe
we can have them come down and speak
to the qualifications of the actual company.
Well, we can't make somebody come down and speak.
Well, we can suspend the rules down.
If they wish to, sure. But I guess my question is, do we have, what's in the arborist report, whether it was produced by a...
I do have a copy here if anyone needs to see it.
Is this the one that was produced on January 17th, 2019?
Yes, January. I mean, our question is, what's there is not what's required. So, by the outline set. Where is it? Here it is.
Yeah, we've got that. All right. It is what it is, I guess. All right. I don't have any further questions then.
It was suggested that the Glenwood Association was holding this process hostage. I heard in your presentation or not?
Pardon me?
I heard you say something about holding a process.
It has been suggested in...
Who has suggested that?
Developers, and it's been suggested in the media.
Okay. Is that okay? That was news to me, so...
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Seeing no other questions, Irene, do you want to speak next?
Okay, I have a few pictures that I'd like to hand in first.
Okay, just present it to the clerk.
Okay, on September 21st, 2018, the appeal to have 11 Clonard split into two 25-foot lots was denied. However, two stipulations were imposed on the contractor. Chairperson Councillor Ornico, Councillor Allard, Councillor Dobson, and Councillor Jabassi all agreed that two conditions should be imposed and gave supporting reasons for this decision. It now appears that this contractor is trying to avoid complying with both conditions. The side stairs were to be changed to grade level to protect the privacy of the east side neighbor. There are two windows on the west side of the neighboring house, and above grade stairs compromises her privacy and security. The privacy of her front and backyard is already gone due to the secondary balcony that overlooks the entire backyard and another above grade deck on both the front and the back of the build. And I gave you pictures to show you what the house looks like. Let's leave a small bit of privacy by ensuring these stairs are grade level as the appeal board recommended. I know that the contractor submitted the reasons he couldn't comply, but come on, he's a contractor and that has been at it a long time. I'm sure he can figure something out. As Councillor Ornico said, put the entry inside the build, or there's the option of moving it the entrance to the back. Councillor Ornico stated anyone entering on above grade stairs would have them looking right into the living room or kitchen window of the neighboring house. He even pointed out that they could wave to each other. These entry stairs touch the property line, and the neighbor's house is also close to the property line, too close to allow any above grade stairs. This condition was imposed for very valid reasons. We have the developer stating the reasons he can't bring them to grade. I think we all know changes to builds can be done and are done all the time. It may cost them to change their plans, or could even be just that it's too much trouble to do. But to not abide by the decision is just wrong. I also want to point out that the Glenwood area to date has had 425,000 square feet of property clear cut. This is on 22 streets. If these four trees along the property line cannot be saved, I'm not sure if there is a tree in the Glenwood area on any split lot that is safe. Trees are obviously just a nuisance to the contractor. This has been made perfectly clear with the arborist report. I think the arborist's name says it all. A report, I may point out, does not even meet the minimum information the City of Winnipeg's own guidelines for an arborist report. Not only do they want to compromise the neighbor's privacy, they don't want to be bothered to protect her majestic silver maple tree. Can you see how the contractors come into the neighborhood with no regard for what is important to the people who live here and have made this their home. They pay their taxes and continue to pay their taxes. Residents have expectations. City Council has their best interest in mind when making their decisions. Let's prove them right and not fold on another contractor's demands. Contractors come, create havoc, grab their money, and run. This is our perception, and after living through 85 lot splits, we have become expert at seeing the contractors agreeing to anything the councillors request of them, and then come back only to apologize why we can't get this done. Don't fall for it. We are asking you to uphold these two conditions that were imposed by our councillors on this build. Thank you.
You just clarify the very first thing you said there about the grade entry. You were talking about loss of privacy of number 13 or?
She would be number 13 or 15, whatever. She's on a 50-foot lot, so it could be.
Fair point.
Could be 15. I'm not exactly sure of the address.
Okay. So I got it now. Okay.
But she has, so they have a deck on the front, they have a deck and a second story deck on the back. So she doesn't have privacy for front or back.
I get my question is to the staff here, which is, I mean, I get that there's a plan approval that's got to come here, but condition 8 and condition 9, whatever one thinks of them, aren't, how am I able to undo either 8 or 9? I mean, 8 is to the satisfaction of the director. So if the director is satisfied with the arborist report, I don't know what I'm judging. And 9 is a flat constructed at grade, whether one thinks that's crazy or not, or good or not. I'm not sure why that seems to be before us. And 10 is plan approval to the Rail Community Committee. So I'm a little procedurally confused here. Am I voting on the...
Certainly 10 is primarily what we're dealing with today, which is the drawings that have been submitted. And there have been revisions to the drawings based on the arborist report, which show which trees, which existing trees can be maintained or preserved. So that is primarily what we're dealing with today.
I just want to point out that the four trees along the property line are right along the fence line, and in the so-called arborist report, because I don't see any initials after his name, so I'm not sure if he's qualified, said that it interferes with the hydro lines, it interferes with the build. These trees have all been pruned up because we're having our hydro poles replaced in St. Patel, and all our back lane trees have been pruned. They're pruned up, and the hydro lines are across the lane. They're not even close. The tree isn't even close to it. And it said it had some dead branches. Our oaks have some dead branches, but that doesn't mean we take them down. We take out the dead branches.
Thank you for your ongoing vigilance on these files. And I think this is not pertaining to this matter.
No, that was what we were supposed to give you earlier.
Thank you. My apologies on that.
Okay. Is that it?
Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is Pam St. Goddard?
Okay, thank you. Okay, as there's no other questions.
that have to say?
No. They're not great.
No, I, yeah, okay.
Okay. All right. So we're going to move to, let's see.
Are we likely to get, if we're getting close to 5:30, Mr. Chair, I might try and deal with this one, but let's see if we can get, because we have to, no, we can always delay the public hearing a little,
yes,
can't we?
Yeah.
Okay.
We
never mind. Never mind.
Yeah.
I'm still on the old clock that we used to use.
Okay, so now we're going to move into reports.
Still have daylight savings, all right.
It's like it's got to start at 5.
We're going to move into reports. Report number one is an occasional liquor permit, Norwood Grove Business Improvement Zone.
I'd like to, I don't know if there is public service recommendation here, but I'd like to approve the request for the permit.
All
so
in,
moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Item number two is a per capita grant for St. Amand Foundation. Assist with $300 in registration costs for the,
yes,
Wild Winter Canoe Race.
So I had meant to check in with my other counselors who could participate on the race. Having not yet done that, I would like to approve, I think it's our $300 contribution to our participation in the race this year. And I'd like to note that Team City Hall decisively dispatched Team Manitoba. So we won the battle, maybe not the war, but if there is a war, but I don't know.
Tired
if there is a war.
Of the war.
But anyhow, we won that race, and everybody was really well. It was a great opportunity to support Santa Ma and to show how some of us have some athletic skills that I was not aware of. So I'd like to move $300 out of Santa Ma's per capita to support this Wild Winter Canoe Race, which is now an institution in Santa Ma office.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Per capita grants for Guidami Franco-Manitobans,
yeah.
$500 for the cost of youth get-together.
I mean, this looks like a worthy initiative. I don't know if there's a date. Madam Clerk, do we know if we've supported in the past? I think it's a new request.
This is a new request.
Okay. I'll support this with $250, same amount as per capita, please.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
So, same office residents association. I would like to, there's a significant funding request of $2,500 this year. I'd like to support with same amount as prior years, $200, same office per capita. This is a residents association speaking, I think, mostly on issues relating to Archwood Terrain neighborhoods, but they have. Anyhow, they've been doing quite a bit of work in the area and like to continue supporting them with $200.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
And then, so Norwood Flats Residents Association, I've had some conversations with some of the proponents. So I would like to support with $500 per capita because this is a one-time cost to support the startup of this association, and their hope, I think, is to create a resident association to speak on behalf of residents of Norwood West specifically, though they haven't had a founding meeting yet. I think they are planning one for next month, but with that, I'd like to kickstart these efforts with $500 per capita.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
So this is Regional Science Fair. We have another walk-on request from Holy Cross School. I'd like to support this one with $200, same amount as per capita. And for some context, so the Holy Cross School has a science fair program that's very well received and has very good participation from students in the area, and yeah, there's a request for $500. This is a new request, and I'd like to support it with $200 this year.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
Another St. Boniface request. Request is for $400, prior year $200. Given the volume of requests for St. Boniface per capita. I think I'd love to assist with 400, but seeing the budget just in this evening, seeing the requests on the budget, I think I'd like to support, but keep the prior year support at $200.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Southern Lights.
Move $100.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Maddox Warriors.
I think I'm putting in 75 and you're putting in 75, Mr. Chair.
That is correct. Do you want to move it?
Yep, also move.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Aye. Carried.
Just want to say it looks like fun.
It's a good little group.
St. Mary's Magdalene Anglican Church.
I don't know if this program is going to go this year, but I'll approve 100, and I guess we'll see if it's to go or not. So I'll move 100 from St. Vital allocation.
Okay, yeah, I don't see an application on here, but all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. I'd like to ask Councillor Aller to take the chair while I discuss the per capita grant for River Park South Community Association. This association has been doing some great things in the River Park South area. They want to continue on with their ongoing efforts to disseminate information in the community through their newsletters, through their social media, and other activities in the area. So I will move that we consider $600 towards the River Park South Community Association.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried.
Next is the Van Hall Estates Neighborhood Committee, who is requesting $1,000 for Canada Day events. Again, it's an opportunity for the local community to come together and support Canada Day. Although they're requesting $1,000, seeing the budget that we're presented with here tonight, I will approve a $500 towards the Van Hall Estates Neighborhood Committee.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Contrary? Carried.
Okay. We have a, I'll take the chair back.
Sure.
We have a request from the Manitobans, Society for Manitobans with Disabilities, has submitted an application for $2,000 for their annual drop zone.
So this was a request that was given to all of the community committees?
Yep. So last year, those $200, do we know what the big breakdown was?
I believe it was $200 per community. It was $200 from St. Vital and $100 from St. Norbert. So $300 was given from.
Huh? You want to do 100 each?
Yeah, I could live with that.
I'm just aware that per capita is pretty tight. So for St. Pete.
Sure. Given the eight of them to commit.
Yeah.
I mean, I might consider this in the future, but.
Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Community incentive grant for Comité Scolaire de Accord Precious Sang.
Yes, so this is an exciting project. It's a school playground renovation project. I had asked to defer this decision to this meeting because I wanted to take a look at the budget and all of the applications and see there's at least three tonight. So with that, I would like to support with $25,000, which is in line with what we gave the Nordale School playground project on a first round. We eventually approved an additional $15,000 to the Nordale project as their fundraising efforts continued on year two, but to be in line with school playground projects that were approved in the past. I'd like to support this very, very exciting project for Pacific Sound School with $25,000 out of same office per capita.
All in favor?
Not per capita, but CIGP.
CIGP. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
And then for this one, I need to recuse myself because of a potential conflict of interest.
So the community incentive grant for Le Petit Bonheur for a play yard development in the amount of $70,000 be considered by Real Community Committee.
I have an email with Eagle about that because I remember last time you guys were asking if it would be possible to still give money from there today if they haven't gone back to me yet. So.
Do we want to hold this over then?
Yeah, I guess.
Okay, so we'll hold it over till we get
May 6th and our next meeting.
Until we get a decision back from legal?
Correct.
Okay. So do I?
Yeah, so
can you move that motion?
I also move.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried. Councillor Allard is welcome back while we discuss the CIGP for Glenlawn.
Not Glenwood, not Greendale. Sorry, St. Vitale. Everything has to have a G. Not Glen Lee.
Oh, this is embarrassing.
Is Councillor Allard aware that he is?
I believe.
Oh, she's okay. Good, good. Or no? Left player.
Okay, Councillor Mays, do you want to speak to this one here?
Sorry, Mr. Chair, that we're on 16?
Correct.
Yeah, I'll move the recommended amount there, $8,572.50. I'll move that into the St. Vitale CIGP.
Okay, all in favor?
Got it.
Contrary, carried. Community incentive grant for ComSpan Incorporated.
They sent me a revised number, so I will approve the awkward amount of
$13,982.63.
Exactly. Any sense? The 63. So much for that question. Get in the game. I'll move that. Yes, out of the St. Vitale CIGP.
All in favor?
All right.
Contrary, carried.
Better skip 18 for now then.
Yeah. And then 19, Landic LDRF.
Yeah, I've tormented the clerks by moving this variously from land dedication to CIGP to land dedication to CIGP to land dedication, I think. Or there might have been one last move. Anyway, let's just get it out of here. It's, we'll approve it out of land dedication, but for $25,000, not the $32,000.
Okay.
So that's out of land dedication, $25,000, St. Vital Ward.
Okay, so I'm no longer doing...
We're doing every basketball court we can at St. Vital, so...
Who's got a basketball, Jones?
Okay. It's, four down and two to go, I think.
Okay, number 20, land dedication, LDR. I'll
call a vote on that.
Oh, sorry, yes. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried?
Yep.
Sorry, for number 20, it was actually on the agenda by accident, so we'll just need to receive this matter as information.
Okay. Can you move that we receive this
as... move that we receive that... What is coming back, Nick? Are we laying that over?
No, it was added.
Oh, this
to
got
the
very confused. Last
it was added.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You're right. Yes. Okay, I'll move that we receive number 20 as information.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried. And 21, LDRF for is this Matt again?
It's actually
or
both of us.
Both
I
of you.
Think.
Matt.
Yeah, I can't remember what the split is here. So.
Right.
22? Yes. Van Du? I'll move that we hold over 23 until till after, as we earlier discussed, that interrelates with the public hearing. So if we can lay over 23 until after the public hearing on the Sage Creek item.
Do we need a motion for that or just?
Yeah.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried. Plan approval for nine.
Oh, and there's Kevin.
Oh, there he is. Okay.
It's right now the live stream on. I don't know what's going on.
We've get, jumped one or two here.
So, Anthony?
Yeah, I'd like to support the public service recommendation for Pearl Streets.
For 21?
What's the
$12,000?
What's the split?
Oh, it's 12.
12,000.
What's the split on this? Can you remember?
Oh, right. Councillor Mays, did you... You were thinking of maybe participating? Or?
Yeah. What if, did we say 8?
Well, I was thinking 12 when I said public service recommendation.
I should have just shut up then, shouldn't I? To be fair, you took it all the last time, to be fair.
Did you want to top up something up to 12, or...?
Well, they're asking for 12. Do you
they're asking... They're asking... I thought it was... They were asking for 12.
Well, there's no... Yeah, they're asking...
Yeah, they're asking for 12. Or 10 and 2 or something?
Sounds good.
Okay,
and just Councillor Councillor Chambers, Cool Streets is it's a neat, I think it's not just St. Boniface. I think they've done, I saw the ward as well.
They do kind of game stuff, I think.
Yeah, but they basically paint active transportation corridors, streets, crosswalk corridors. So they add some color to our Winnipeg streets.
Were they the ones that did the pride flag at the Human Rights Museum on that corridor?
Was it painted?
It was painted.
Possibly, but not sure. Yeah. Anyhow, it's a. I mean, it's.
I've seen the concept.
Yeah, it's a nice addition to our streets when we have money available. So.
Okay.
So I'd like. Oh, so it sounds like $10,000 from St. Boniface line dedication, $2,000 from St. Vital. And that way, Councilor Mays and I can celebrate the initiative together.
Oh, see, I see there's a bit of coercion here.
He paid for it.
Well, no, I wasn't implying anything.
So why don't we do this way?
Yeah.
We can go 8,000 from you
and
2,000 from Councilor Mays and 2,000 from me.
That's great. Sure.
That way we can all celebrate this.
Well, I was not expecting that, but thank you very much for the support.
All right. There we go. Okay, so all in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried.
You may want to go back to 18, Mr. Chair.
18, Vance Sweet.
Oh, so Catholic Health Corporation, this is a really exciting application, and I think we're definitely getting our money's worth. You see the total project is something like over 180,000, so I'd like to support the public service recommendation, and this will be a beautiful addition to the work that's already been done just adjacent with the Taché Promenade project, and hope that this is one of many riverbank beautification projects in the surrounding area. The idea is one day to have, they call it the loop, and that's a walk that you can do from the Forks to St. Boniface and then back to the Forks, so our people who are visiting Winnipeg as tourists can have this like increasingly interesting pedestrian experience going from the Forks, checking out everything there, hopefully coming down to St. Boniface, visiting the French Quarter, and then you can do the full loop in, I don't know, 40 minutes, something like that. It's a nice walk, and it's getting nicer and nicer every time a project like this is approved.
Perfect.
So I've moved the 20,000 from St. Boniface per capita, or St. Boniface CIGP.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. And then we're going to 22. Okay, so plan approval, 473 Rashad Street in St. Boniface.
Right, so it says plans available to meeting.
R.M. of Rochelle.
So there's something there now.
Did you want to review the plans at all?
Well,
you're privy to them. It's our committee. Our committee is voting on
this.
So the plans are only paper. So.
Okay. What's the lot width? Moving the approval?
Yeah, I would move the Urban Planning Division recommendation on this.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Aye. Carried. 23? You want to?
Former Councillor May is now Councillor Lard. So
okay. 24?
Yeah, this is the one that we heard some deputations on. I have found Veritas to be a pretty good player in the development of infill housing. I found the Glenwood Neighborhood Association to be very concerned about their neighborhood. This is the first and perhaps unfortunately not the last of these ones that are getting, or the first that I remember, ones being referred back for plan approval. We've got to get some guidelines here because this is just going to create another hurdle and people are going to get even more upset if they can't win. There'll be four appeals for every bloody house in the neighborhood. It's just starting to get to be a little much in terms of taking up our time and energy, but I do appreciate the developers trying to fit into the community. The community is exercising their democratic right to come out. I'm fine with the drawings I've seen, so that's number 10. Number 8, I don't think that's in front of me. I think that's a report that whether one likes the arborist report, the director hasn't indicated it's unsatisfactory. We have the delegates here of the planning department, so I don't think that's in front of me to decide whether also the wording with respect to retaining and 5 trees, frankly, wouldn't what does that legally mean? It's not even a sentence. It's part of this process. So does it mean retaining the 5 trees? Does it mean something else? Who the hell knows? But that's what it says. So
They're at least retaining the one tree, right? They're retaining the thing on the east, they're the...
The maple?
The...
Silver maple? Or the...
Or whatever it is, it was to the satisfaction of the director. I don't know what to say about number nine. It's not, to me, that's a valid point that neighborhood reps are raising, which is it's not being constructed at grade level unless there's some different legal meaning of grade level. And I appreciate there's a lengthy letter in there explaining why, but what am I to do, to waive the condition that the appeal committee put on? How am I to do that? That's not in front of me. I think, I mean, we're just getting into more and more of a quagmire on the infill stuff. So I don't think nine is like, what am I to do, waive that? That's not referred back here. So, Madam Clerk, I don't know what, I mean, if my only... So frankly, I don't think it's proposing construction at grade level, and so that's what the appeal committee said. Whether you like it or not, that's what they said. So I don't know how I'm supposed to waive that. Is that part of the plan approval, the height of the – does the plan approval include the height of the door?
The condition is not worded such that that – condition is tied into it.
I agree.
We're using this set of drawings to look at the changes versus the original set of drawings. And based on the letter from the engineer and the reduction, we're satisfied that it meets the intent.
Well,
this is on the height?
This is on the height.
Yeah, I was on that appeal committee. I remember John moving that. He seemed to think that this was something that was done through plan approval.
Well, thinking aloud here, why are we having people come down here to speak to issues that aren't really in front of us then? I mean, if 8 and 9 are not under my, under the power of this committee, neither was, like, I really don't, I guess we're going to need to be much clearer in future on what it is to refer plan approval here.
Well, I know I can speak for myself as a participant in the appeal committee. If there's
I'm gonna want
to learn from this experience in the future.
Are you satisfied? I mean, the intent. I mean, if it's this much up from grade, it's, you know, there's a reasonableness standard here, I suppose. But fire away.
No, I mean, I just procedurally to your point, Councillor Mays. If we're doing stuff at appeals and we're referring it back to community committee for plan approval, then on elevation, I'm going to want to learn from this experience to know that 100% for sure that we can deal with it at community committee through plan approval in a way that makes sense to the community committee.
So was there any specific reasoning why they want the entrance on the east side to be constructed at grade level as opposed to...
Yeah, I mean, I think it's to what some of the delegation said, there was some issues that John saw pertaining to privacy, people being able to look into windows, that sort of stuff. I think that was what the elevations were about. And I was there, and I had voted on the at the appeal committee with the rest of the committee.
So was the original plan to have it higher than grade level on steps first?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, I mean, my recollection of that conversation was we're looking for a concession that would ensure additional privacy to the adjacent landowners. So.
Well, you see, my dilemma here is if I vote no based on number 10, then number 9 isn't really part of number 10. So then Veritas is going to appeal up saying,
go back to appeals?
Yeah, we had this on some... That god awful one, which there was a recommendation to tear it down. Yeah. Guidelines.
On this we agree, Councillor Allard. I'm going to give plan approval then. I'm sorry to the people from Glenwood who came out, because 8 and 9 don't seem to be part of the plan approval, and I can only vote on the plan approval. So I suppose there's an appeal lying from that, which I wouldn't blame them if they brought forward, and then we can discuss at the next committee whether the intent of grade level was met. But I mean, God knows we discuss other things that can turn 2 inches this way and that, so wouldn't be the first time. So I'll move that we approve the plan approval. But man, this is a great example of the dangers inherent in referring these things for plan approval, and then the other conditions start to get in the midst as well.
The public can't appeal this.
Okay. So that was going to be my question.
Yeah. This is only appealable by the owner or the applicant. Because this is, it's not a variance. This item is not a public hearing. This is just a plan approval. So the only person that would be able to appeal it is the applicant.
Fine. Then I'll move that we don't approve it, and let's just have it out at the next committee so we don't ever do this again. Because this is, it's just unbelievable what we're spending our time on here.
Okay.
Sorry, so you're not approving this?
Right, which I then can get appealed, and then we can sort out at the next level what it is we are doing. This is just a gong show.
Okay.
Through no creation of anybody at this table, but...
So then the motion is to not approve the plan approval.
And then we have the understanding that
it goes to
the proponent can appeal and bring it to appeal committee.
P&D appeals. Okay.
Is there?
I don't know. I mean, I'm happy to discuss this. I just, what are we doing?
Is there a fee to appeal for the landowner? There's no fee? Procedurally, it would mean one more meeting?
I don't know. What's your thought?
If you're questioning the process, then I don't think it's bad to bring it to appeals. I mean, presuming the proponent will even want to go there, I guess there's a chance that this is the end, but probably not, considering where it's gotten to at this point. So policy, you're saying that you're being asked to rule on elevation.
He does have a year to appeal.
So, Councillor May, when's our next elevation?
Can we lay this over for up to a certain period? I don't want to delay.
Oh, we can lay it over forever.
No, you can't. Not the plan.
Oh. Can we not lay it over at all?
You can lay it over, but laying it over would work the same way as a public hearing. So you can only lay it over to the third consecutive meeting.
So it's not a public hearing, but it has the same
the plan approval. Yes.
You know what? I would like to lay this over because we're going to start getting sued here. Just this whole thing is just anarchy at this stage. So that's maybe a little strong, but I will move to lay it over to our next meeting if there's a special
meeting.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
And what are we hoping will come by laying it over? What new information or additional information?
Well, so I think Councillor May is looking to clarify whether or not elevation is
part
of the responsibilities of the plan approval. I think that's your main point.
Yes.
Because there was discussion at appeals.
The tree business appears to be completely outside the scope of what we're doing. Like, we can't, and
the tree was just Arbor's report.
Faulting the chair here. I'm just trying to get clarity on what it is we're... It also becomes difficult for the public to comment on plan approvals when these will be made available at the meeting. So they don't know what the hell these things look like. So.
Well, what we will do is, now that we have the plans, we will scan them and we will post them in the minutes.
That's helpful.
So... now that you're laying this over, the public can view it as well. Once it comes next month, they still have that opportunity to speak in delegation to them.
All right. Okay. Let's do it that way.
So the motion is to hold this over till the next meeting.
Yeah. With the understanding
with the understanding.
Plans will also be attached to the minutes.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. So, Councillor Allard, could you take...
Yep.
Does he need to take the chair on this one?
Yes.
Because I'll be...
He'll be moving some motions? Is this Report 25?
This is Report 25.
Okay. I'll take the chair.
Yeah. So I'm supporting the application for the variance on this. There is a request of the proponent to consider a variance.
It's just the design review.
Oh, the design review, okay. Which I am supporting. In this particular instance, though, I just want to... To indicate that, so I'm not speaking to the variance at all.
No, the variance is done. This is just the design review.
Okay, so I'm approving the design review based on the submitted plans. Noting that there is a request for a variance.
No.
This is 3555 Pembina.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we have
is the variance part of the public hearing?
So when the application originally came forward, they did need a variance for that step back at 25 feet because of the tower component. So because that variance was already granted, this application doesn't need a variance because that came through the original approval.
Okay.
It's just that it doesn't meet the intent of that original approval.
Okay. So I'm moving to accept the design plans as submitted.
So you don't, okay, so you're not concurring with the,
recommendation of, and so just noting that this is a one-time precedence in terms of my reasoning for approval or not signing with the recommendations at this point.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary carried.
Okay. We move to 26, which is been moved by Councillor Mays.
Yep. Okay. If you're back in the chair.
I'm back in the chair. Councillor Mays, would you like to speak to this?
No, I'll just move it.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. Number 27, renaming of Shelley, renaming of a park to Shelley Glover.
Yeah, this is to in honor of the former MP who lives very close to this park. This park was part of her riding. There is no signage at present in the park. So it seemed appropriate to me to name this one. And I guess this heads up to Councillor Rowland's committee from here if it's passed, and we'll test the waters there.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Contrary? Carried. Councillor Allard, will you take the chair?
I will.
Number 28.
Thanks.
Number 28, I'm requesting that, you know, whereas the area south of Aldgate Rose has experienced significant population growth over the last 2 years, new families have purchased homes in that area. Whereas many children of these families south of Aldgate attend Highbury School and walk to school, which is on the north side of Aldgate Road, and whereas Highbury School is also accommodates children from other schools who attend there for vocational programming on a daily basis, and whereas traffic is a growing concern early in the morning and throughout the school days, children walk to and from school, and whereas a crossing guard cannot be deployed unless a traffic calming mechanism is installed, and whereas the volume and speed of traffic appears to have increased on Aldgate despite the posted speed limits. Therefore, be it resolved that the Standing Policy Committee on Infrastructure Renewal and Public Works requests that the Public Service conduct a traffic study to determine if a crosswalk at Aldgate Road and Highbury Street is warranted.
So moved. All in favor?
Aye.
If I can just good work by Councilor Chambers on this has been this one. It's been around through a couple of different councilors now. The issue's on Aldgate, so thank you for trying something down there, and we'll see what comes back. But I know it's a long-running issue. So
anyway, yeah, is this where the speed tables are?
No, this is further west.
Okay.
Just west of Dakota.
All right. I look forward to seeing this at the next level. So all in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, carried.
Okay, I'll take the chair.
Sure.
And then we've already done the non-conforming. No, we haven't.
Yep. I'm going to take the chair back.
Take the chair back.
Okay.
So we're I'm recommending that we hold this over till the next meeting to gather some additional information.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Contrary, carried.
And we can take a break now.
If you'd like to deal with new business after the public hearing, because we do have to start public hearings by 6.
Yeah.
So
is there any new business?
Did you want to take a break? Oh, we got need to take a break.
Yes.
Let's do that.
Yeah. I have inside information.
Back at 5:59.
Okay, back at
5:59?
5:50. 5:55. Okay.
By 6 o'clock.
By 6 o'clock?
Yes.
Okay.
So all persons who wish to speak or receive notice of the hearing body's decision or recommendation must fill out a public representation form and submit it to me as soon as possible. Copies of this form can be found at the registration table outside the council chamber at the top of the stairs. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, the process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application. Next, those registered in opposition are heard, followed by those registered for information. Finally, the applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. Please note that when your name is called, it is your opportunity to speak. However, you are not obligated to do so. This is the public hearing process brochure, copies of which are available at the registration table. This brochure contains an overview of the process and other information pertaining to what happens before, during, and after a public hearing. As information, all public hearings are recorded and will be part of the public record. Should you have any questions after the public hearing is concluded, please contact the City Clerk's Department. Item 1 is the subdivision and rezoning at Crestmont Drive under file DASZ 27 of 2018. So the applicant is Mark Brown and Brock Feenstra and Curtis Swatsky. I don't know if you're all coming together. Whichever order, whoever would like to go first.
Good evening, and thanks for the opportunity to speak at this.
Could you just state your name?
Yeah. My name is Mark Brown, Senior Development Manager at GenStar Development Company.
Okay, great. Thank you.
I was saying good evening before I did that, so my apologies. Good evening. Thanks for the opportunity to speak at this hearing this evening. The intent of our development application, DASZ 27 of 2018, is to rezone a parcel of land from R1M to RMFS and to subdivide 20-foot wide side-by-side lots for two-family residential use. The subdivision and rezoning is being contemplated to further diversify housing in the area and to include housing options for a greater variety of housing types. The subject lands are located on the eastern boundary of the Bonavista neighborhood, adjacent to Melnick Road and Lajimodier Boulevard. The area falls under the policy and planning guidance of the Precinct K Secondary Plan, and the proposed rezoning, as mentioned in the planner's report, is consistent with the secondary plan and complete communities direction strategy regarding new communities. We've read the planner's report and are appreciative of the support that has been lent to this application. That being said, we would like to bring up a few matters that are of importance to us and a broader level to our industry. With respect to the planner's report, we'd like to look at the recommendation for a zoning agreement, specifically provision 2A1. This is a condition that looks to restrict the width of driveways to 10 feet, requiring a minimum 15 feet of non-hard servicing to the opposite property line. This was a little confusing. We'd like to know sort of what the rationale is for the 10-foot restriction on the driveway width or the need for a minimum of 15 feet of non-hard surfaced area. We're just trying to rationalize why this specific width was being required And does it achieve the goal of providing flexibility with respect to snow storage and utility placement? I guess our question would be, is there any backup data or information that supports the specific width requirement or that provides a rationale for limiting driveway widths? A little bit of background, at a minimal, typical single-car garages built in the city of Winnipeg include a garage with a 9 to 10-foot entry and 1 foot of driveway on either side. So the standard single driveways are 12 feet wide, not 10 feet wide. We did provide a copy of the plot plan for the 30 proposed lots, showing the conceptual location of the two-family homes, adjoined driveways, and garage locations. The driveway widths were shown at 12 feet wide, with substantial areas of non-hard surfacing also shown. Based on this, we're asking that this condition is eliminated or at least modified to limit driveways to standard widths of 12 feet instead of 10 feet. From our experience and our industry perspective, the issue here regarding hard surfacing and conflicts with snow storage and utility placements, streetlights and hydrants, is really due to the 1.5-meter approach flare-outs that are required at the end of the driveways. This has been brought up to administration a number of times, and we look forward to addressing this in the future because it's becoming a very substantial problem. The second condition we'd like to discuss is 2A2 that requires plan approval for all two-family homes. There was an excerpt from our zoning agreement that was included in the planner's report. I just wanted to point out it's not actually the correct excerpt from our zoning agreement. Our current zoning agreement that covers the entirety of Bonavista does not require plan approval for single-family or two-family homes in RMFS zones. And we want this provision to remain constant on a go-forward basis. Regarding plan approval, it is noted the city does not have any adopted, accepted, or standardized residential design guidelines, and as such, it's unclear to us as to how designs will be assessed and whether assessments will be consistent across the city. We'd like to know what exactly will be enforced or required through the plan approval as it relates to two-family dwellings. Without residential design guidelines, there's no basis for analysis or rational definition of the expectations in design. We're not sure what or whose design interest is being considered in this respect. As you may know, Genstar communities are subject to our own architectural controls and guidelines. These guidelines are developed and implemented by professional architects and urban designers, building technologists, and professional planners. The guidelines are well-defined, specific, and contextually appropriate. They specify design and finishing requirements based on defined architectural style, for example, prairie style, modern, farmhouse, traditional, etc. Efforts are taken to prescribe measures that contemplate the entire streetscape, consider site grading, building height, driveway, and approach slopes, and so forth. The guidelines also take the local market into consideration. In this respect, our guidelines are quite robust and effective. To this date, I'd ask, has there been an issue in Bonavista where our guidelines for single or two-family homes have proven inadequate in relation to the city-defined design requirements? Once again, based on the aforementioned, we respectfully ask that this requirement for plan approval for two-family homes is not included in the zoning agreement. Condition 2A3. This one is another one that caught us a little off guard. It limits the protrusion of front attached garages to 3 feet from the front of the home. The planner's report cited public safety and crime prevention through environmental design, or SEPTED, as the basis of the condition. Essentially, it's inferred that garage protrusions restrict eyes on the street or passive surveillance and therefore compromise public safety. By our account, when developed, there will be no fewer than 57 homes or household eyes fronting onto the street. The street as public space and homes as private space are clearly visible from a variety of angles. The planner's report is unclear if there's any sightline analysis or concrete data, precedents, and so forth to rationalize this condition. We did a quick scan of SEPTED literature and design interventions and were unable to find any direct link in a similar context between protruding garages and reductions in public safety. Keep in mind, the back lanes are also public space, with detached garages adjacent to public lanes throughout the city. Would this issue not be the same in those areas, if not worse? I can't, just, once again, we're trying to determine the interest that's being protected with this particular condition. We're not convinced that this is even an issue, as there appears to be no evidence, data, or justification suggesting that it is indeed the case. Additionally, requiring the recessing garages that far into the footprint of the home greatly reduces their flexibility, efficiency, and affordability. The general public should have some choice in footprint and layout of their homes, and we should be trying our best to promote affordability and choice and not to reduce it. Implementing something like this without defensible background information, public engagement, or industry consultation serves no purpose from our point of view. We therefore ask that condition 2A3 be removed as a condition of the zoning agreement. Just want to mention that people do live in Genstar communities for a variety of reasons, one of them being their inherent safety. According to the permit stats and statistics, in 2018, Bonita Vista was the most popular new community in Winnipeg, and our Amber Gates neighborhood was the second most popular community. Evidence suggests that we are building diverse communities that are aesthetically pleasing and safe. Never have we encountered a situation where protruding garages have created a safety issue. If it was an issue, we would know about it and address it, because more or less our livelihoods depend on it. And finally, point number four in the planner's report is a recommendation that requires Genstar to contribute cash in lieu of land dedication. This subdivision or planning area was approved, I believe, in 2015 in its entirety, at which point we made our land dedication to the City of Winnipeg. We actually over-dedicated by almost 2 acres to accommodate a future community center at the requirement of the Parks Department. So we view this requirement as further dedication to be a bit of double dipping, so we're asking that that condition be removed, or that comment be removed as well, too. So that concludes the representation tonight. If there's any questions, I'd more than happy to answer.
Go over number four again for me. Everything else I get, everything else I have a view on, subject to further delegations, if any, but
sure.
Clarify that business with the LDR, because that seems... I voted on Precinct K 5 years ago, but I cannot remember, shockingly, what we said about LDR off the top of my head. But what? So Genstar saying already...
You already took land from us, and now you're asking for cash in lieu of land, is my understanding from the report.
Okay. And there is no doubt there's the 14-acre site there, the park that Councillor Allard named...
That's correct. That's part of the overall PR.
Part of it, yeah.
Yeah.
Can we hear admin's thoughts on that one?
So certainly there has been land that has been taken through the previous agreement, but we would like to leave it in. We worded it very specifically that it's as to the determination or determined by the director. So that if it's determined that no additional dedication is required, then that is how it would be handled. But we want to have it in place in order to make that determination.
Okay, we can probably have our cake and eat it too on that one. If we just add we can just add a clause clarifying. I mean, what you're saying is perhaps, I can agree with that, but it just needs to be a little clearer in the text.
Might I add, though, we do have a development agreement. In the development agreement, it recognizes that we over-dedicated by 1.76 acres, and the development agreement specifically states that the city will not ask us for any further contributions in the future. So it's in putting that in my mind, seems contravention of the existing clause in our development agreement.
I'm wondering, I know there's a reference to sidewalks and active transportation. Is there no requirement for sidewalks? Requirements for sidewalks?
No.
There's no requirement for sidewalks?
There is no requirement for sidewalks.
But there is reference to it as, you know, you're gonna, some sidewalks and some active transportation in some parts.
Yeah, all our regional roads, collector roads, and I believe some of our residential roads either have an active transportation path or a sidewalk in front of them, usually one on each side.
Yeah.
So there's quite a bit of active transportation and sidewalks in the community in comparison to communities that were approved, new communities that were approved at that time.
Okay. No longer my ward, but thought I would ask the question.
Okay, any additional comments, questions?
Okay, so the four issues then, other than the four issues you've highlighted, you're okay with the report. So the four issues being the driveways, the plan approval, the
protruding garages,
and the land dedication.
That's correct.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
So, is there a Brock Feenstra?
I'm here in support.
You're here in support. And Curtis Sawatsky? Not here? Come in. Is there anyone whose name has not been called who wishes to speak to this application? In support? Or in opposition? Or for information?
Okay.
Okay.
The committee can just
Okay, so we can just confer and...
Yes.
So...
I'll find the... here we go. Okay.
So how many units are we creating?
Look like... what is it?
How many?
30.
That's okay.
30. Just wanted to point out the stark contrast between infill and sort of mature and existing neighborhoods and greenfield developments during the deliberations we've had tonight. Better point that out.
Fair point. I won't undertake this, but I will note the partway through the report, it talks about this being in St. Vital Ward, but at the very top, it says it's in St. Boniface Ward. So I don't know when this was prepared, but it's in St. Vital Ward. The tricky thing is there's another report coming on Schulberg, whatever that's, the street 6 inches from the boundary of this is in Councillor Elliott's ward. So it's a bit tricky how there's a public road opening or laneway or something coming that's actually in Councillor Elliott's ward. But for tonight, this is in my ward. Away we go. Okay. I will move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Contrary? Carried.
I'll move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried.
I will be moving some amendments to the recommendations Madam Clerk, stand by. So there were four concerns. A, Bonavista it's an exciting area. I'm actually quite pleased to represent it. There's some interesting things going on there. There's certainly an attempt to develop in a more dense manner than some other developments. So some interesting and creative things going on. And the park that is Fraypont Park, named by Councillor Allard, is a tremendous community asset with the lookout there. So looking forward to the neighborhood filling in. And this is an attempt to further densify that neighborhood. So I would say on the four concerns that were raised, yeah, I'm fine with the standard 12-foot driveways, not the 10-foot driveways. That means it's not going to be, these are not 12-foot wide lots, so you will have the issue with the flare of the driveway, but rather than being 10-foot limit on driveway, it would be 12-foot limit on driveway. Okay.
Or 3.96 meters.
Okay. So if you can. Okay. So on that one, I agree with the Genster representative. I'm happy to have it come back for plan approval. Well, perhaps not happy, but I'm not convinced we don't need that. So we'll leave that alone. I would take out in its entirety the.
Okay. Sorry.
Sorry, Madam Clerk. Am I?
Firstly, you need to concur or not concur in the recommendation.
I concur in part with the recommendation. I concur subject to amendments.
To amendments, okay.
All right.
So your first amendment, you're saying that 2AI, it is now, instead of 15 feet, you're changing that to 13 feet or 3.96 meters.
Is it 13 or 12 feet?
12-foot wide driveway, 13-foot gap.
Gap, okay.
12 feet on either side.
Okay. So that's... Change number one, change number two?
No change number two, plan approval still.
Okay.
Delete the business at 2A subheading 3.
Delete.
I mean, if we start bringing that in, that would infer that about half of River Park, so about half of the old St. Vital Ward is unsafely designed with protruding garages, and I'm not prepared to concede that. And I've hit every door in River Park South, east of Dakota, and I've hit them all now in Bonavista. There aren't that many in Sage and Rowan. No one has ever said to me, geez, the problem with the neighborhood is these protruding garages. So, I mean, I live in a split level from the 60s, and I'm sure the easterly part extends more than 3 feet out. So I would delete that one.
So deleting it
in and the LDR, can we just add at the end of clause number four there, it's not equal to 10% as determined by the city's planner. add a second sentence there, or after comma, after Director of Planning, Property and Development, comma, noting that land was dedicated as part of the original zoning agreement.
Sorry, so I, so the full thing, or do you have better wording?
Maybe you could refer back to it. So per DAS said 21 of 2014.
Per DAS said 21 of 2014.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because this phrasing suggests it's 10% of the appraised value, and the director has to figure out the appraised value, whereas I think we're saying something slightly different, which is, well, if they're under-dedicated, and the evidence is actually to the contrary, but if they are under-dedicated, mm-hmm. then the director will
It'll be
take
zero.
Cash. Yeah.
So, okay.
Well, no, if they're under-dedicated, it will be
money. Oh, it will, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry.
So just so I'm clear here, so the full condition here will say that in lieu of the dedication of land, the developer shall provide a cash payment in an amount equal to 10% of the appraised value of development of the development application number DAS said 27 of 2018 as determined by the city's director of planning, property and development department, and the land that was dedicated as part of the original zoning agreement DAS said 21 of 2014.
Hmm. Is that? You guys know the technical parts of that, so.
I don't think and gets
no.
the correct connotation there. I think subject to any arrangements made under.
Arrangements made as part of DAS at 21 and 20. We can figure
yeah,
out.
Yeah, let's.
Okay. I don't want to double dip. On the other hand, I don't yeah. want to waive money that we're entitled to. Mm-hmm.
Okay. We can work on the appropriate wording, but that is your intent. No double dipping.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll figure that out. Okay. Okay. And those are the three amendments you are making?
Yes.
Okay. So this will be forwarded to the Standing Policy Committee on Property and Development because there are amendments.
Okay.
So that is your motion.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried.
And now the bizarre business that we then provide supporting reasons, which we still are waiting for our legal folks to comment on, years after raising this. Mm-hmm. What I said earlier, good, interesting new neighborhood being built in a denser manner than some of the other suburban neighborhoods. This is part of that effort, so happy to try and keep working with Genstar on this neighborhood, and we'll sort out the LDR issue. And on I appreciate the importance of crime prevention, but I'm not convinced that it, yeah. in this
particular
instant that's that we needed to have that 3-foot limit.
And then I'll just add my comments. I'll be supporting as well with Councillor Mays's amendments. I do want to point out the issue of they're not being sidewalks, I guess, everywhere in the development. I know there are some on some of the regional streets and some references to active transportation, but I understand this comes with the Winnipeg Public Service recommendation, and if there were to be sidewalks everywhere, there would be some policy work required, I take it, given the Public Service recommendation that we see here today. I'll leave my comments at that for now.
Good.
Okay. Moving.
All in favor?
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried.
I think I need to move the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Contrary? Carried.
Please note that the committee has made a recommendation on this matter that will now proceed to council. No further representations are permitted, and all persons registered for the public hearing will receive notice when the matter is considered by council. Item 2 is a variance at Daisy Van Nam Boulevard under file DAV 105964 of 2019D.
Okay, so we've got some people that will be speaking in the order of, just put my glasses on, Trevor Grafton, then Brian Ward, then George Patera. So, Trevor?
It's Brian again. Trevor is with me. We'll try to speak together to keep our time efficient. Brian Ward from Qualico Communities. I'm the general manager of our communities, our land development group in Winnipeg. Trevor Grafton is with me from Qualico. He's our in-house landscape architect and does our design approvals. Maybe landscape designer still? Designer, sorry, Trevor. Dealing with architectural approvals internally. And George is representing the builder if there are specific questions. And it was up briefly earlier just to deal with the plan approval, which we'll deal with after the public hearing. And again, we have no concerns with the report as presented by the administration for the variance. It's a little odd for a variance to come to this committee, but it has to do with the fact that this property was rezoned less than 2 years ago. So the variance comes to this committee rather than Board of Adjustment. The reason for the variance is primarily that we are trying to build townhome style multifamily product on a fairly small site that does happen to have multifamily medium zoning. So the yard requirements are quite substantial in that you could, in multifamily medium, be looking at a four-story or plus apartment building. We're proposing two-story townhome homes with front doors to a street. They would be accessed by a private back lane, which would connect to a public back lane and an adjacent private access point that provides access to a five-story apartment building immediately behind the townhomes. Each townhome has a two-car garage, and again, we're primarily looking for relief from yards. Some of the yard or front side yards, and again, part of that is to do with the existing zoning, which is multifamily medium, and part of it is to bring the townhomes up to the street in accordance with the secondary plan, as pointed out in the administration's report, and very much consistent with townhomes elsewhere in the Sage Creek neighborhood, where we have front yards that I think at the smallest range from about 6 feet up to 14 or so feet throughout the neighborhood. Again, happy to answer any questions or go into any further details as the committee might require.
Councillor Mays?
Thank you for the presentation. So you've read the report.
No concerns.
Okay. Yeah. Couple of things. Will these look a lot like the ones just south east, the ones that run north-south on Daisy Vernon?
The ones that run north-south on Daisy Vernon would be, they were built by a different builder. Okay. They will look quite different. Those are, I believe you're talking, are referring to the Blue Stem products, which is sort of a three-story townhome where the main floor is the garage from the internal backyard. These are two-story. They will look much more like single-family homes that would be across La France from these homes. The builder is one of our builders that builds single-family in the neighborhood. Their townhome product that they have built is the one just north of the one that you're referring to. So just right beside the daycare that's under construction. So between Blue Stem and the daycare, that was a Randall Homes product, and it's the same builder that is building this one.
Why is the address Daisy Vernon? Seems like the address should be the lane, right?
La France?
La France. France.
We don't pick the addressing. That's dictated to us by the administration and which side the numbers should be on.
Okay. But it's going to be facing...
Each individual home will face La France. Their front doors will face La France. Yes, they will walk out their front doors to the sidewalk on La France.
Okay. Okay, and it's not, I wondered if it was the three-story, but...
It's not, it's a little bit different. The buildings are sort of maximum of 4 units per building, so there's a number of buildings to make up the total of 10 units, so there's some nice breaks between them.
I get complaints about snow and the back lane across the ones that are on Daisy, but what's the deal with snow here?
Because they're...
The private lane, presumably... The
private snow clearing. Yeah, so their lane will be dealt with. This will be a condo project, so they will be dealing with their own snow clearing on site. Presumably, they will coordinate with the apartment building adjacent to them to deal with their shared access. and then the city is responsible for the back lane that runs between them and the property that fronts on Burning Glass Road, which will be developed in the future. And so that would get cleared like any other city back lane.
Okay. Good.
Seems very aggressive to build on that very small parcel of land there.
It's similar in depth to what a single family or another townhome block would be. We've lost a little bit of depth because we have to do the private back lane in order to ensure that there aren't front drives onto La France. So that back lane is sort of replacing what would typically or otherwise might be front drives. So it does make the site look a little more condensed and does push our building slightly closer to the front, but it is certainly in keeping with sort of the lot sizes and the yards with the townhomes that were built in phase one in Sage Creek. There's another development where there's, again, a variety of between 6 and 10 foot front yards. And the front yard variance is really, we're going down to 7.9 feet in the smallest, and that's to an architectural detail that's providing articulation to the front of the building. The front of the living space of the home is about 10 feet from the front yard lot line, and the buildings have some variety built into the depth. So there are some of the buildings where their architectural feature is actually about 8'9" from the property line, and the living space is 11. So the variance is down to the closest unit, which is not all of the units. So there's a fair amount of variety and movement in the building, which is something we've been working with our builders and the administration to ensure as part of the project.
So are there street lights on this street here? And I mean, how close are they going to be to the homes? And well, is that going to be an issue where you're going to have a street light basically right in the window of a house?
Well, any of the street lights and street trees would be in the boulevard in the city's property, which would be outside of that front yard. Mm-hmm. So the front yard would end, and then we'd have the sidewalk and then the standard city boulevard. With any of the utilities and lights.
Close up to, there's only a 10-foot space?
Yes. Which, again, has been very much in keeping with what we've done elsewhere and along collectors with single-family homes at around the 14-foot front yard, and it hasn't been an issue. The street lighting typically, as I understand it, not being a transportation or lighting engineer, is designed to light the traffic or the vehicle portion of the street principally. Mm-hmm. And the new lights in particular really limit light pollution outside of that area. And so the lights are very much focused on the vehicle area rather than protruding back into the private property, sort of regardless of how far they are.
Any questions or comments?
Yes.
Okay. Next. Thank you very much, Brian.
Thank you.
Trevor Grafton? Or?
I think Brian spoke.
Brian spoke, and same with George. Yeah. We're all good?
Yeah, we're here if there were specific questions about the architectural or the building. These are the experts. So.
Okay.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you.
I had one question for admin. I'm not sure why it's in the applicant may comment. There's a couple times we see that the land that's over by Lash is included here. That's sort of the town. Are we in the town center district or something here? Like it just seemed like
this is one of the blocks that in the secondary plan is are considered part of the village center, I think, is fair, and I defer to admin if I'm misspeaking, but I think this block as part of the land to the south of the lane, which is commercially zoned currently, has all been thought of as part of the village center and is the highest density piece of Sage Creek. It's the place where we've been trying to encourage higher densities, small yards, buildings closer to streets, more direct access from buildings onto sidewalks. And I think, as the administration's report points out, this is very much in keeping with that direction. To achieve that, we do need some variances because of the zoning. And this is a special part of Sage Creek, and it is a little bit different, even though it is fairly in line with other areas where we have this style of housing, but this is definitely the densest, the smallest property where we're fitting this style of home.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, I'll find the script here then. I'll attempt to find, where is it, at the top? There we are. All right, do I need...
Well, I guess I would point out the number of delegations over here.
But that, but, I mean, it is, one could argue this is infill, right? Because it is, in a sense. It's, I mean, you know the neighborhood as well as I do, right? I mean, this is not... further southeast down to the perimeter here. This is dropping it in next to that the red lily. That stuff's been there for like a decade or more, probably, right? Burning glass. So,
right.
Arguably, this is, that's a good example of it. It's the difficulty of defining infill, right? Because it is, in the Sage Creek sense, just as the Devereaux building.
Yes.
Buildings, plural, are infill in a sense, which is good, because then, you know, pound people in next to the bus loop, you get better bus service, hopefully.
Right.
Yeah, and these guys will be, I think, 50 meters from the bus line, the number, what is it, you've got number 10 or something, so.
Right.
Point taken.
Yeah. Maybe not the same as the last application.
probably a more pure example.
Right.
Yes. All right, I will move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor?
Aye.
I'll move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried.
I'll move that in accordance with subsection 247.3 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan. It does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway. It is the minimum modification of the zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated. And now we give the supporting comments. The supporting comments are kind of what Councillor Nallard and I were just talking about. This is trying to densify Sage Creek area. It's near the transit line. It's part of the evolution of the community, so that's good. It's filling in where there's a gap. A lot of this townhouse type development, which I've talked about in Sage Creek, on Burning Glass, further on up by the daycare. So it's certainly not all homes with 50-foot frontages here. They're trying, as we've said here before. They're trying to be have some diverse housing options there. So I'm supportive.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried.
I'll move that the recommendations of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and the variance be approved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried.
I'll move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried.
Please note that the committee's decision with respect to this application may be appealed. Should you wish to appeal, information on how to do so will be included in the order issued, which will be mailed to all persons registered.
Thank you.
So now number 23, the plan approval for the amendment.
So that goes back to 23. Okay.
I already got that.
Sorry, the plan, Elise?
Yeah,
she put that. That's what you have right now.
Yeah. And have you, admin, any concerns?
No concerns.
You're ready to go? Okay. Then, okay, we're on number 23 then?
Yeah.
Chair? I'll move approval of the plans as submitted.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Contrary? Carried.
We just need a new business motion?
Is there any new business?
I think I had some, yeah.
I think you guys
did.
Well, I have.
Okay.
I move that.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. new business.
I'll move number one that William W. Childy being added to the Real Community Committee Street Name Reserve list.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried.
So I had one for Niagara Park Residents Association. They're asking for $100 to support the Niagara Park book swap. I'd like to move $100 as per the request.
The Niagara book what?
Niagara Park book swap.
Okay.
Yeah. Specifically to purchase books for children's books baskets.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. And then number three, per capita grant for the Francophone Chamber of
Commerce. Yeah, I think we already passed this one earlier.
I don't think so. Is it, or is it a separate one? This was given as new business. So it's 1995, the enterprise of the chamber. I thought I approved this earlier in the meeting. So they're overcome with excitement over that. They're looking for 250. I just saw that for like tonight, so.
Or maybe I saw it in the email.
Yeah, Ryan sent it just before the meeting to you and myself.
Okay, well, I will. So we supported the Chambre de Commerce for their, that's probably what it is, just saw it in the email, for the Soirée d'Entrepreneurship. They're requesting $1,000. I'd like to support, I'd love to have support for $1,000, but I'd like to support, like we did last year, for $250.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Aye. Carried. And that's it. We'll need a motion for adjournment. There's no other votes.
I can move that, yeah. Or Councillor Mays did.
And we have a seconder, Councillor Mays. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. And we are done.